The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Okay, so Riley suggested a title and I liked it, so I took it. And not knowing what everybody was going to present before me, I included things that have been discussed in some way, fashion already, but hopefully I can skip over those topics or visit them in a different way. I'm going to talk to you mostly about the way that these geoengineering ideas have been explored in climate models and maybe where the challenges remain, what the inadequacies of the studies that have been done to date are. And it's important to acknowledge the many people who I've worked with on these projects over the last 5 years or so, and I'm sure I've left some out also, but I've caught most of them and I'll try and acknowledge them as I go along as well. So I've worked on both stratospheric aerosols and on the cloud seeding calculations, and I'm going to touch on both of those topics. Just to keep the story going, I included this, but I get to skip it over because Mike and Alan have talked about it as well. And as I said, most of my focus is going to be on stratospheric aerosols and cloud whitening. There have also been some interesting studies recently on looking at ways to increase long wave emissions, and I know that's something that Graham is also interested, but I won't talk to you about that today. But in order to start things off, I'm going to just remind you of what we typically use for global climate models today. We divide the planet up into columns about 100 kilometers on a side and produce a layer structure which looks something like this, with model layers that are order 100 meters thick near the surface, and then as you move up to a few kilometers, maybe 4 or 5 kilometers, they increase to a kilometer or two, and by the time you reach the tropopause, there are more like 2 or 3 kilometers in thickness. So our ability to resolve many of the features that are important for climate problems and for the processes that we're talking about is really crude right now, and we pay the penalty for it. You'll see that in many ways in the studies that I tell you about. You've all heard about Pinatubo already, and this is Alan has frequently indicated to me that this is a picture of the not the major eruption, but a few days before that major eruption of Pinatubo. But what we do know is that the planet cooled following Pinatubo. The black line here is showing you a time series of the globally average surface temperature from a study by Brian Soden. And the red lines here are showing you climate model simulations that attempt to simulate the globally average temperature response of the model to the burdens of aerosols that were seen to be introduced in global climate models. So I'm showing you here one of the success stories in the sense that the model temperature response is something like we see in observations. And there are even more subtle things that occur. If you look at the water vapor distribution and compare it with observations, the water vapor burdens in the planet are controlled to some degree by temperature and by the radiative forcing that's associated with many aspects of the climate problem, but in part due to the aerosol forcing associated with Pinatubo, and we get the appropriate response here, as well as approximately the appropriate response in what's called the water vapor feedback also. So there are some things that climate models are quite good at. On the other hand, there are some things that we're challenged by at the moment. And I'm going to remind you here of some of the processes which control stratospheric aerosols and how they're represented in models, as well as how we think the real world works. So I've taken this cartoon from a very nice assessment document produced by Spark in 2006. And essentially, it's a cross-section of the planet from the equator to pole, showing you the place where stratospheric aerosols occur, just above the tropopause, and the essentially the processes which control the evolution of the aerosols and their removal. There are many sulfur-bearing species which originate near the surface, and by hook or by crook, they're relatively rapidly transported from the surface to the tropopause and undergoing oxidation processes as they go. And at some point in the game, those sulfur-bearing species are oxidized to sulfuric acid or some related species, where they can undergo condensation and new particle formation, and then vapor deposition on existing particles as well, and the particles can coagulate. At higher altitudes, when the temperatures start warming up, those particles can actually evaporate, and the sulfuric acid can undergo photolysis back to SO2 and then get reoxidized elsewhere as well. So you see this relatively narrow band of aerosols at the tropical tropopause. And in order to do a reasonable job of mimicking this, you have to represent the processes of condensation and coagulation, of sedimentation, evaporation, and transport as well, and the removal processes that are responsible for removing them in the tropopause. And all of these things play a role in our ability to represent the stratospheric aerosols. If we do that kind of thing, we get distributions that look a lot like what are seen in the observations, and I'm showing you here a simulation that I did in 2008, showing you a similar cross-section with the aerosol surface area density plotted here, and then a top-down view of the aerosol distributions. In this case, what we did, these are geoengineering aerosols, and these were introduced in the tropics at about 20 kilometers in altitude and as SO2 gas, and then the SO2 gas gradually undergoes the processes that I described to you on the previous slide. And what you see is that the aerosols tend to maximize in the source region where the emissions are and in the polar regions as well. I'm showing you here the summertime distribution for the northern hemisphere so that you can see that the maximum in the radiative forcing is occurring in the tropics and at the poles where the aerosol has relatively high aerosol burdens and where the sun is shining also. So these are the sort of methods and tools which we're using to produce the kind of simulations that Alan and I have talked to you about. And when you impose these aerosols in a coupled model, you can see, as a geoengineering aerosols, you can see the planet cool down. The left panel is showing you a temperature distribution from our model in which we've instantaneously doubled CO2 and then in a slab ocean configuration run to an equilibrium, and what's happened when we've imposed the geoengineering aerosols, and the planet does cool off as we expected it to, and has been suggested by many modeling studies since that time. In this case, we chose a scenario which didn't completely counteract the CO2 emissions, but it's pretty close. But there are some subtle things that go on as well, and here I'm showing you the time series of this globally averaged surface temperature for a set of simulations. In this case, it's a bit flawed, but the mechanism that I want to discuss with you is present in models that are in simulations that are not flawed as well. And what I'm showing you here is the time series of the surface temperature change for a variety of simulations. The blue dots here are showing you the warming that occurs in a slab ocean model, a model in which the ocean dynamics are prescribed rather than allowed to evolve dynamically. And these classes of models equilibrate much more rapidly than those coupled models that include a full ocean circulation. So you see the model warming up by, in this case, I think it was about 2 degrees. And then I'm showing you another simulation here in which I introduced a certain amount of geoengineering aerosol. And in this case, I introduced aerosol which was sufficient to cool the planet by
more than the amount that the CO2 doubling would produce. But when I couple these two effects, when we make a simulation in which we've superimposed the geoengineering aerosol with CO2 doubling, then in fact, rather than the geoengineering aerosol overcooling the planet, in this case, it remains warmer than the control indicated by this dashed line. And the reason for this is because the atmospheric dynamics are beginning to operate. And in fact, in a doubled CO2 world, the flushing of aerosols from the stratosphere into the troposphere is enhanced. And so you end up moving more of the stratospheric aerosols into the troposphere, and the lifetime of the aerosols is shorter. So it's just kind of indicating to you some of the subtleties that are introduced by the coupling of these various processes, and that some of those couldn't be anticipated in the absence of doing the coupled simulations. Alan has showed you this plot already. We have recognized for a while that many of the geoengineering strategies will influence the hydrologic cycle, and I had thought Alan would describe the mechanism for this in his presentation, and so I didn't include it in mine. And it's too subtle to describe without some slides, so maybe we can talk about it in the later sessions if people remain interested. But one of the things that I want to point out to you is that there is a lot of uncertainty in the representation of and our ability to project climate changes associated with precipitation. I'm showing you here a summary of precipitation change projections from the AR4 IPCC. This is for the ensemble of models that were used for that fourth assessment, about 20 models, I think. And the things to focus upon are the areas in white where less than 60% of the models agreed on the sign of the change, and the stippled areas where more than 90% of the models agreed, and the many colored areas which are neither white nor stippled, indicating that there was little consensus about the sign of the changes. And the take-home message here is that there is a lot of uncertainty about making projections of regional climate change with respect to precipitation. And we see these kind of signatures in our geoengineering simulations as well. And I'll show you a few examples of that here. So in this case, this is from a review paper that I wrote with Alan and a bunch of other people a few years ago, in which we first, in this case, I'm documenting the response of our model, the precipitation changes in our model to a doubling of CO2. The red area is indicating where the precipitation has increased with respect to a control simulation, and the blue area is where it's decreased. And this is a pretty familiar signature with a net increase in precipitation over the globe and an enhancement in the hydrologic cycle with increased precipitation in the tropical regions and decreased precipitation and a narrowing of the ITCZ. But if you then, and now, the stippled regions are showing you where the simulations in our model were estimated to be statistically significant. If you impose the geoengineering forcing on it by introducing the stratospheric aerosols, then in this case, the white areas indicating little change with respect to present day increase. So this geoengineering simulation is returning the planet to something that looks more like present-day precipitation distributions, and the colored areas in both positive and negatives are much reduced. So take-home message is that in this case, in spite of there being some consequences to the precipitation distribution, as we suspect from, for example, the Pinatubo simulations, that our Pinatubo record, of precipitation, that there would be changes to precipitation. The models are suggesting that the geoengineering would return the planet to something more like the present day. But if you contrast this then with one of Alan's simulations, he also showed a similar signature with a reduction in the differences between present day and a world undergoing both, in a world undergoing changes due to CO2 forcing. Then the other thing that you'll note here in their simulations are that the signatures in most places, you can look at Southeast China and in India and over the northern part of South America, for example, are quite different. So Alan and I performed these simulations in slightly different ways. He used a fully coupled simulation and used a transient CO2 forcing. I doubled CO2 and used a slab ocean model as well, but we would anticipate that many of the signatures would be common between these two simulations, and they're not. On the other hand,
I would say they're quite different because we had different forcing for global warming and different forcing for geoengineering.
That's right. Although the distributions of the forcings for the geoengineering would have been quite similar, and the spatial distributions for the forcings would have been quite similar. Although the relative amplitudes of those would have been different. On the other hand, then Andy Jones and Alan published a paper, and they're both their teams, Andy Jones from the UK Met Office, doing a similar kind of an intercomparison activity. And they found some more common features than the features that Alan and I found in the comparison of the NCAR and GIS models. So there are more common features between these two simulations than the ones that we saw in our first paper. And this has argued for the set of studies that Alan mentioned earlier on today, the GeoMIP intercomparison activity, where we begin to try and do a very careful intercomparison of models rather than the sort of after-the-fact intercomparison studies that we used to date. So another topic that was mentioned earlier on were the subtleties of the way in which stratospheric aerosols are parameterized or operate in models. And there was a very interesting study that was done by Jeff Pierce recently and contrasting it with some of the simulations by Karhonen that Alan mentioned earlier on as well. Exploring the subtleties of aerosol microphysics, and I'm going to try and walk you through that here by showing you the evolution of size distribution of aerosols versus number for a variety of different ways of making stratospheric aerosols, and remind you of the fact that for a given mass, if the mass exists in smaller aerosols, they tend to be more reflective, but they also have a higher surface to volume ratio, and so they, since the ozone loss reactions occur on, are a function of the surface area of the aerosols, it's easier to deplete ozone if you have small aerosols. And also, I want to remind you that larger aerosols will fall out faster. So if we start by just looking at a idealized distribution of background aerosols, which I'm indicating here, and contrast them with the aerosol size distribution that occurs following a volcanic eruption, then what you see is the volcanic eruptions tend to produce more aerosols at most size ranges, and the mode of the aerosol distribution tends to be larger as well. Of course, these large particles fall out more rapidly also. But if you then try to produce a geoengineering aerosol by introducing SO2, then what you find is that instead of many new particles being formed, as occurs often in the volcanic eruptions immediately following the eruption, a lot of the of the sulfuric acid gas that is produced by the introduction of the SO2 gas will condense on existing particles, and those particles will grow larger than they would otherwise and fall out faster. And this is the explanation for the forcing effect that Alan showed in his in one of the figures, and I'll show in a bit. On the other hand, the study by Jeff Pierce with David Keith and others have suggested that another mechanism for doing this would be to introduce sulfuric acid gas and directly and allow it to make new particles immediately, and that the size distribution that is produced is relatively insensitive to the nucleation mechanism or the coagulation mechanism. And what you get are many smaller many particles at smaller sizes than you'd otherwise get. And so these are things which we're speculating about and require exploration in a variety of different models. Some of the models which we use need to represent the a bin resolved size distribution or a bin resolved set of microphysics, but they need to be allowed to evolve to spatial scales that are relevant to the climate problem also, so that it can be quite complex to explore these processes. We already talked about this study, and so I think I'll just jump over it. There are also consequences to ozone, and Simona Tilmus and I, maybe some other people in this room, were co-authors on a paper which tried to evaluate the changes in ozone. It's actually the fact that in some parts of the atmosphere there's more ozone being produced than you would get without the geoengineering aerosols. But if one looks at the column burdens, then for much of the planet, particularly in the high latitudes, there are fewer, there's less aerosols, less ozone, sorry. On the other hand, one thing that you have to keep in mind as well is that the models are not at the moment particularly good at simulating ozone distributions, and Mike Mills, or maybe Brian Toon, may want to comment on these things as well. But what we showed here were estimates of the ozone evolution from 1980 through the future. The diamonds here are, or the triangles rather, are observations of ozone loss and of ozone itself. And of ozone depletion, sorry. What we expect to see is as chlorine gradually returns to levels that are that occur in the absence of CFC releases, that ozone depletion will be reduced, and that if we introduce geoengineering aerosols, that the depletion will remain significantly higher. And this kind of study is relatively useful and accurate for the southern hemisphere Antarctic vortex, where we do a reasonably good job of modeling it. But in the Arctic, we don't do a very good job of modeling the Arctic vortex evolution with often too frequent sudden warmings. And our ability to represent the present-day ozone loss reactions is compromised, and we're less certain about what the future will bring with or without geoengineering as well. We're also quite aware of the sensitivity of our current model simulations to the way that we represent things like sea ice dynamics, with the projections of geoengineering being very different depending on how we introduce the mechanisms for ice growth and ice movement. One of the other things which hasn't been mentioned yet is we are concerned, for example, that through the introduction of geoengineering, aerosols will introduce more ozone loss. And of course, one of the reasons why we care so much about that is because it influences how much UV radiation reaches the surface, and it's important for biota and for ecosystems in general. But there have been a few studies which show that stratospheric aerosols of the size range and composition that occur for stratospheric aerosols also attenuate UV radiation, and that at the aerosol optical depths that are required for geoengineering, that there might be a balance between the amount of UV attenuated by the stratospheric aerosols and the enhancement from ozone loss. So that's one thing which hasn't been looked at in much detail and deserves more study. And as we've already mentioned, the stratospheric aerosols don't deal with ocean acidification. So Graham talked a lot about ship tracks like this and the role of open and closed cellular convection, and so I won't spend much time on it. This was a figure that was in my mind when we were having our conversation about the areas for that were most susceptible to geoengineering. This was from a study that I did a while ago with John Latham, and the assessment of where we might seed was actually done by a postdoc of mine, but in this study and a variety of others, the marine stratocumulus regions were ones that were identified as being the most natural for the for a geoengineering type activity, and so it's particularly interesting to contrast that with the work that Graham showed. I'm now going to show you a set of simulations that we've done with where we've introduced geoengineering aerosols by increasing the cloud drop number in these regions. We just have said, let's magically assume that we could introduce sea salt aerosols into the model. They would act as cloud condensation nuclei and change the cloud drop number. So what we've done in this case is in this case, what I'm showing are the months of the year that we seeded these particular regions. And you can assume that we always seeded in the summer months, for example. And what we've done is to assume that in these regions we could increase the cloud drop number of the boundary layer clouds to 300 drops per cubic centimeter. And so we haven't explored at all the subtleties of the aerosol cloud interactions that Graham talked about earlier on. But what we might expect as well is that if we do brighten the clouds in these regions, that we would see very different signatures of the climate effect, because we would be significantly reducing the amount of sunlight in small regions of the planet small regions of the planet compared to the kind of signatures that one would produce using the stratospheric aerosols, which are much more global in extent. So if we look then at what the response is of the coupled model, in one early study that we did, we saw signatures in the precipitation distribution, which looked like this. Again, with reductions in the ITCZ in the Central Pacific, actually enhancements in the North, northern part of the Australian monsoon circular system. And interestingly enough, we see an increase in the precipitation occurring over the Amazon. This is to be contrasted with a similar study that Andy Jones did with the UK Met Office model, where they found that the introduction of geoengineering aerosols in marine stratocumulus has resulted in a decrease in the Amazonian rainfall. Now, in that case, they then teased out what was the particular forcing signatures which were responsible for this reduction in Amazon rainfall, and they determined that it was primarily the brightening of clouds off the coast of Africa. Which we didn't do because we didn't have very much marine stratocumulus in that region, and so that it wasn't possible to brighten the clouds in that region. So there are suggestions that there are important things that are remain to be looked at with respect to our understanding of how the precipitation is responding to changes in these forcings. Now, I'm going to skip forward and come back to. This is a similar figure. Well, Fui, I've lost the slide that I wanted to show you, so I guess I'll go back to where I was. Okay, so with respect to the issues associated with geoengineering by boundary layer clouds and as well through stratospheric aerosols, you can kind of partition the way we think about the climate science problems into two pieces. One is to say, if we could achieve the forcings that we want to by the geoengineering strategy, what would be the response of the planet? And we can use general circulation models to look at those kind of questions. But then you could also say, do we really understand how to achieve the geoengineering effect that we want to? Is it possible to brighten clouds? Is it possible to produce the stratospheric aerosols that we're looking at? And in those cases, it's often necessary to look at detailed process level models as well. And I've suggested that for the stratospheric aerosols with respect to the evolution of the particle size distribution, but there are similar kinds of questions which we can look at with the boundary layer clouds also, and many of the things which Graham talked about are relevant to that. So I'm going to touch on a few more things with respect to the exploring the impacts on climate, and then talk to you more about the, or finish with one slide with respect to process level modeling also. I showed you the precipitation distribution changes that were associated with geoengineering by boundary layer cloud seeding. This is the temperature distribution in a circumstance where we're seeding 20%, this is the temperature change for a doubling of CO2. In the situation where we seed 20% of the ocean and where we seed 70% of the ocean. The signatures here are very similar to each other, but of course, the amplitude of the ocean response is larger when we seed more of the ocean surface. One of the interesting things that we see is that the model is tending to move into a La Niña-type circulation. And so there are there's some real interest in attempting to look at what the effects are on ocean circulations as well. And another thing that one will see is that there are significant changes in the North Atlantic temperature distribution here. And this is an area where deep water forms and where the meridional overturning circulation is being driven. Mike?
70% of what? Of the ocean?
Of the ocean surface is being seeded. So it changed to 300 drops per cubic centimeter.
Even though there are not clouds there or whatever?
Oh, it's, or is it, if there is a cloud, it is, it, it it will have the value of 300 drops per cubic centimeter.
For 70% of the clouds there, you are...
Yeah, it's so it's...
Where there are clouds.
Where there are clouds. That's right. So there are hints in this kind of a figure that there will be changes in La Niña, El Niño, or ENSO type signatures, as well as in meridional overturnings.
So the model's a coupled model?
This is a fully coupled model.
So how long does it take to run this to a state?
I think in this case what we've done is to run the model for 100 years and average the last 40 years of the simulation. Well, that's right, in order to see this response. But in virtually every geoengineering simulation done to date, what we've tried to do at the moment is to exaggerate the effects to see if we can extract signal to noise. But
Phil, yeah. You say you seed 70% of the ocean. Do you discriminate which clouds you seed in terms of how thick they are?
No. We seed all clouds in the lowest 2 kilometers of the atmosphere. All liquid clouds.
But only 70% of the clouds are being seeded.
70% of what we've done is to take every cell of our model,
yes,
and to rank it by its susceptibility to cloud seeding. And then choose the 70% of those columns over the oceans
that are most
susceptible, yeah, and then apply that seeding strategy there. Yeah. That's right. It jumps, so it repeats. We've analyzed this month by month and imposed this seeding strategy on choosing the cells which are the most susceptible in each month, and we repeat that pattern year after year after year.
Oh.
Okay. That's right. And so and under those circumstances, we wouldn't do anything because there wouldn't be. If a cloud formed, we would assume that it would be seeded. There are also changes in the latent heat fluxes. And of course, that's associated with evaporation. And it's also responsible for changes in the precipitation distribution. And this would require a discussion of fast and slow forcing and response that I don't have time to talk to you about. The sea ice is, in spite of the fact that the forcings that we're imposing are primarily in the subtropics, the heat transports are global in nature, and you see a response in sea ice even though the forcing is imposed primarily in the subtropics. So we see, with a doubling of CO2, a loss of sea ice. This is familiar for most coupled model simulations. The sea ice responds with geoengineering, and it's actually possible to overdo the effect with additional enhancements over what we've seen, what we get with our present-day simulations. And I've talked about that figure already. There are also changes to the deep ocean and upper ocean. And I'm showing you here in the top left panel the temperature changes that are associated with a doubling of CO2, with the yellow areas showing an increase in the surface temperature of the ocean. This is a cross-section of the global ocean basin. And the result of imposing the geoengineering seeding or geoengineering by boundary layer cloud seeding. And warming of the near surface waters is gone, or much reduced, in the geoengineering simulations. And if one looks at the meridional overturning circulations, these are quite, it would take a while to explain them in much detail, but these are showing you the differences in the meridional overturning circulation between a run in which we've doubled CO2 and a control, with the red areas here showing you a reduction in the strength of the meridional overturning circulation, and the left panels these two panels, this is a global cross-section, and this is for the Atlantic only. The left panels are showing you the results from the doubled CO2 simulations, and the right panels here, the results for in which we've imposed the geoengineering. And what one sees is that the geoengineering has reduced, significantly reduced the impact on the MOC. Giri Stenchikov has also explored the impact of volcanic signatures in the ocean, and I think Alan might have mentioned this as well. And I just stole a few notes from his abstract that volcanic cooling is tending to strengthen the meridional overturning circulation. And in this case, our geoengineering simulations are with the boundary layer cloud seeding is doing the same thing. So we see that the doubling of CO2 is tending to weaken the overturning circulation, and in this case, geoengineering is tending to strengthen it as well. So I'm now jumping to a focus more on the process level, and Graham spent a lot of time talking to you about these things, so I won't, but just say that these are the kinds of issues that we as climate modelers are worrying about, and recognize that we don't have the tools to do this necessarily in the context of a global climate model. Other kinds of models are required. And then to discuss a couple of the subtleties of it. In 1998, Steve Gann wrote a nice paper in which he pointed out that that there's a competition between various kinds of aerosols, and that if one was to introduce additional aerosols into the boundary layer, that various effects might occur. In this case, what he pointed out was that increasing sea salt could have a variety of different effects depending upon the circumstance for clouds, that in pristine conditions and strong updrafts that you might, that increasing sea salt fluxes might increase cloud drop activation because the accumulation mode sea salt particles are actually activating. But under other circumstances, in polluted conditions with weak updrafts, that increasing sea salt fluxes can actually decrease activation due to competition with the coarse mode sea salt particles, which is something that Graham was talking about as well, or would occur with these giant nuclei. And these kind of processes have been looked at briefly in global models, but not particularly effectively at this point in the game. Hanale Korhonen published a study a couple of a year ago now, in which he attempted to explore those effects with a very detailed size-resolved microphysics model, but a model in which all of the dynamical processes were prescribed, unlike the kind of models which Graham was talking to about, LES models. And under those circumstances, she found that supersaturation was lowered by the extra aerosols that were being introduced, and that natural aerosols were not activating under those circumstances. And then under other situations, she pointed out that there was another mechanism, that increasing sea salt might make the pH of the water more alkaline, which affects the rate of aqueous oxidation of any sulfur dioxide or dimethyl sulfide that's present in the boundary layer, and that this in turn is going to influence the rate of new particle formation as well. So these kind of questions actually, although they're interesting and absolutely relevant to the geoengineering and climate activities, are much better dealt with in the context of a resolved cloud model or an LES model. So I've shown you in a previous slides that different general circulation models are producing different signatures for precipitation. And we have begun an effort to tease out that kind of response in our models. And I had a second panel on this slide that I wanted to show you and can show you in a perhaps in another circumstance. But I haven't gotten permission from my colleagues at the UK Met Office to show that figure. So what I wanted to do was to tell you that because of the very complicated feedbacks in the climate system, when we try to introduce these perturbations in clouds and look at the response, we've attempted to back off from that circumstance and return to some of the strategies that were first suggested by Bob Sess probably 20 years ago by imposing sea surface temperature changes in our climate models. And what we've done with the Met Office group is first to define a seeding region in a particular coupled general circulation model, introduce the seeding of boundary layer clouds in that region, and identify an SST response and a precipitation response, and then impose that same surface temperature perturbation in another climate model and look at the response in that other climate model to see whether we get the same kind of responses in precipitation or cloud fraction or many other fields. And you'll have to take my word for it that if I was to show you the response between the NCAR and the UK Met Office model in the context of this, that this intercomparison, that the response is quite similar across the two coupled models, indicating that it's the precipitation distributions are actually being influenced by ocean atmosphere feedbacks, for example, and not necessarily by the subtleties of the cloud distributions themselves. So we're not very far along in that study.
About three minutes.
Okay, so I'm going to skip this one. And I think I'll finish up by showing you one simulation which was done by Hailong Wong, Graham, and I, and recently appeared in a ACP paper, in which we've sort of made the logical extension of the studies that Graham introduced you to, and begun to explore the response to various seeding strategies, whether you introduce one ship into a model domain or multiple ships into polluted marine stratocumulus or pristine marine stratocumulus or stratocumulus which are occurring in weak subsidence and stronger subsidence, and identify the response to the of the albedo change in this model or the cloud systems. And so what I'm showing you here are animations where we've introduced three ships, and you can see the an estimate of the CCN distribution introduced by the ships in the right colored panels and the albedo response in the left black and white panels for a pristine situation and a more polluted situation. And then when we've taken this same source distribution but distributed it uniformly over the model domain, what you can see are that there are different responses to the same injection rate depending on many of these circumstances. And I think I'll close there and open it up for discussion.